This conference will now be recorded.
We'll start with the session now. Okay. So this is the agenda for UVM training. We will start with understanding what is UVM, why we need a methodology, UVM overview, then we'll go over object-oriented programming basics, UVM test bench architecture, then we'll talk about reporting classes, then we'll talk about facing a simple UVM test example. Then we'll talk about UVM base classes, UVM command line processor, configuration database, resource database, factory, TLM 1.0, monitor and scoreboard basics, sequence, virtual sequencer, AHP protocol we'll discuss, then AHP UVC development, monitor, subscriber, scoreboard. These concepts we'll be talking about. Other than that, this is the advanced topics we'll talk about. Just please go through this list once. So we'll talk in advanced part of UVM, we'll talk about sequence libraries, TLM 2.0, synchronization classes, policy classes, pools, phase jumping, register layer classes, callbacks, comparator, heartbeat, report catcher, and register layer development for USB 2.0 core verification. Other than that, we will also do AHB interconnect. Model functional verification. In summary, this part of the training, this course will be for 7 weeks. This would go for around 3.5 weeks. This would be for around 3.5 weeks. This is what is covered as part of the UVM essentials training. That would be for around 3 to 4 weeks. Later part of the training will be advanced training. So we will categorize the students into two categories. I mean, the people who want to only do the essentials of UVM and the students who want to do essentials plus advanced. Why this kind of classification is done is, as a fresher, if you want to get into a job, industry doesn't expect you to know advanced concepts of UVM. For example, phase jumping, you don't need to know. Most of the policy classes you don't need to know. You don't need to know TLM 2.0. The industry doesn't expect a fresher to know concepts like heartbeat, report catcher, how you develop register layer. These are all the some value addition, but they are not essentially required for a fresher to learn. You may say, why should I not learn? I mean, it will only improve my chance of getting job, right? But the point is, given your limited time, how much you can do. I mean, learning these concepts again will take another 2 months to gain expertise in these topics. It will take another 2 months time. Rather, you can spend the 2 months in improving the fundamentals like digital design, Verilog, system Verilog. Hence, we classified this into two parts. This is the essential part. This is the advanced part. Now, whereas if I take an experienced engineer who is already working in the job or someone who is already very good with system Verilog and the basics, they can go for the entire course. So this is how the classification has been done. So the next slide, we will have the weekly breakup. So in the week one, that is today and tomorrow, we will talk about these aspects: need for methodology, UVM overview, object-oriented programming basics, UVM test bench architecture, reporting classes, facing, simple UVM test example, UVM base classes and UVM command line processor. In the next week, we'll talk about these things. We'll introduce you to AHP protocol. Then we will do AHP UVC development and some all the component development. In the following weeks, we'll have these topics being covered. So as we go to those specific weeks, we'll talk about those things. I don't think you will anyway remember this. So we'll go in the order in such a way that you are able to follow the UVM in a structured manner. Okay. So let me start off with the session now. I mean the core UVM training now. No, Praveen, you will be, even though you are attending advanced UVM, you will have to attend this UVM also, this essential part also. In summary, the UVM essentials is for 3 to 4 weeks around UVM. Advanced is 7 weeks. It includes UVM essentials. So as soon as the essential is done, the remaining part of the training will continue. Now the course schedule. I mean, most of you have joined from system Verilog training, but for the people who are new to this, new to UVM, I mean our institute, new to VLS Guru Training Institute. So the schedule will be as follows. The course is divided as two things: weekend course, weekdays course. I mean full week course rather, I would say. Weekend course, it will be Saturday and Sunday, 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. will be theory session done by the trainer. 2 p.m. to 6 p.m. lab session guided by the trainer. I mean, where student will be working on the course assignments. Now, the coming to the course assignments, we will be doing following assignments in the course. So these are the assignments we'll be doing. One assignment based on setting up UVM template test engine environment, one assignment on objections and faces, one assignment on reporting classes, severity and verbosity, one on factory, one on TLM 1.0, one on config DB and resource DB, one will be on sequence library, one will be on virtual sequencer and virtual sequence, another will be on policy classes. Like that, totally 16 assignments are there. One assignment needs some update, we'll do that. So totally 16 assignments you will be doing. This 16 assignment list is for complete UVM course. Whereas for the people who are only doing basics, they don't need to do everything. They may have to do only 7 to 8 assignments. This around initial 6 assignments. Then they will be doing command line processor 11 and 12 and AHP UVC development. Of course, we don't stop you from doing it. You can do that. And if you need any help also, we can provide support with that. Our whole intent is you should not do everything and you should not spend your time doing something which is not really very important for you. As I said before, for a fresher, being good with digital design, Verilog and system Verilog is much more important than learning advanced concepts of UVM. Generally, these all concepts are expected from an experienced engineer, not from a fresher. You are expected to be good with the fundamentals of UVM, which includes this list. Hence, we have limited only to this point. Okay, now coming back to the schedule, course assignments, we will be sharing. So the trainer will provide guidance with UVM course assignments. In the full week course, this will be there. 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. theory session. Monday to Thursday. 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Lab session will be there, guided by the trainer. So you can decide in which category you fall into. I mean, do you fall into weekend course? Do you fall into full week course? In some cases, if a student is attending from USA or Canada or any place where the time zone with the time zone difference, we will arrange, we can arrange dedicated lab sessions. If there are multiple students are there, may not be for one student, if there are multiple such students, we can plan for some dedicated lab session. But it will be good if you can join into one of these lab sessions. But if there is a specific requirement, we can always plan for dedicated lab sessions. So that is about the schedule. The course assignment I have already shared with you. The course material. So we will be sharing UVM labs, whatever labs the trainer will be doing, trainer coded labs. And other than that, notes, like I maintain a notes as an institute, most of our trainers maintains their own notes. Whenever we do the session, we maintain a notes. Those notes will be shared with you. Other than that, UVM project codes and the user the user guide or reference manuals, these are openly available. And any specifications, any design specification, any specifications. So all these things will be shared with you. Other than that, a document which indicates on how to update resume. So all these things will be shared with you. Before I go ahead, do you have any questions regarding the course structure, timings, course content?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, please tell me.
Sir, actually, in this agenda, sir, go to this agenda, please.
One second. Yeah, please tell me.
Sir, in that agenda slides, you store two columns. In the first column, you are talking about some basic things, and the second column is that is there for experienced people. You talk about.
Yes.
Actually, both the things will cover, na, sir. Because
yeah, when you go for advanced course, both the things will get covered.
We will join this course, na. I mean, say this is also including this advanced course, or we need to go for something else.
No. See, if you are going for a 7 weeks UVM course, it includes everything.
Okay, yes. Okay. Yeah. For 7 weeks course, it will include everything.
Everything, yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. So whole idea is, as I said before, idea is to make sure that the freshers don't do the things which they don't need to do.
Okay.
So let us start with the UVM now. First, let's understand what is UVM. UVM stands for Universal Verification Methodology. First, let's understand how UVM evolved. Object-oriented programming based HVL. What does HVL stand for? Hardware Verification Languages, evolved in late 1990s. So initially, before system Verilog, we had Vera and Specimen E languages. There were two languages. Vera was Synopsys proprietary language. Specimen E was developed by another company, but later Cadence acquired that company. So Vera was promoted by Synopsys. Specimen E was promoted by Cadence effectively, right? Because it purchased the other company. Why they were doing, EDA companies developed HVLs. HVL stands for Hardware Verification Languages and methodologies as a way of promoting their tools. How would it help promoted tool? If you give a advanced way of verification, I mean, till 1990s, let's say till 1995, for example, or 1998, people were using or rather than calling people, it should be verification engineers. We're using Verilog based verification, which is, as you know by now, it is not efficient way of verification. Now tomorrow someone comes and tells you that I will give you a more effective way of verification, that is by using some advanced languages like Vera and Speckman. You will start using those languages, but to use those languages you need to use the tools which are developed by these EDA companies. Hence they started developing their own languages which would make the verification easier. So these HVL based test benches have a lot of things in common across test benches. If you take different test benches, they have a lot of things in common. What does it mean by that is, if I take a design, let's say this is my DUT, which has got two interfaces. It does not matter whether it is memory controller, whether it is USB controller, whether it is keyboard controller, whatever it is, our test bench will look more or less same. There will be a BFM, there will be a generator, monitor, coverage, a reference model, another monitor, a slave model, assertions. Then you can have a checker, you can have a scoreboard. So, and these are all connected to each other. Essentially, this is what our test bench will look like. If you take BFM, this is what I'm calling as the BFM, bus functional model. This is generator, this is monitor, this is coverage, this is reference model, this is checker, scoreboard, monitor, slave model, assertions. It doesn't matter what is the DUT. DUT can be a DMA controller, it can be USB controller, it can be keyboard controller, it doesn't matter. The structure of test bench you see will not vary much. Only thing that will vary is the coding that goes into BFM, the coding that you do in monitor, the kind of coverage groups you develop will vary, but the structure will be similar. So what it means to say is, as we develop test benches, for different designs, we notice that test benches have lot of things in common. What is that is there in common? Let us understand now. Okay, what is there in common? Let's understand. I think I haven't noted here. So test bench have common things like in all test benches, scenario is generated by generator block. Scenario is given to BFM. BFM drives this scenario as per protocol, interface protocol. And monitor collects these transactions. And monitor gives these collected transactions to coverage and reference model, and reference model gives expected transaction, and checker compares expected transactions with actual transactions from the DUT output port. And scoreboard keeps track of these matches and mismatches. In summary, it does not matter whether we are verifying design A, design B, I mean to say more specifically PCIe controller, USB controller, what you verify, The kind of test bench you develop and what you do in individual components of test bench has a lot of similarities. That is where we need a methodology. What is meant by a methodology? The way of doing things. That is what in English methodology means, the way of doing things in things, right? That is where they found that since a lot of things are common across test benches, which enabled developing base classes which can be used in every test bench. So the first thing they did is they develop base classes which can be used in every test bench. For example, since in every test bench generator is responsible for generating scenario, they developed a base class called as UVM sequencer. In case of UVM, okay, I'm not talking about other methodologies like OVM, RVM. In case of VFM, they developed a component called as UVM driver. In monitor, they developed a base class called as UVM monitor. Reference model, they developed a base class called as UVM scoreboard. Like that, they started developing base classes, which can be used by use of inheritance and extending the actual driver from the actual component from the base component. You get all the functionality of the base class. In that context, there have been many methodologies that got developed in the flow. One of the initial methodologies was RVM, which stands for Reference Verification Methodology. Then came around the same time, RVM was based on Vera language. It was ERM, e-reference methodology was based on Speckman E language. It was based on Speckman E. Then came advanced verification methodology. It is based on system Verilog. See, by around this time, when these methodologies were starting to come, system Verilog got standardized. I mean, the industry started moving from Vera to system Verilog, Speckman E to system Verilog. VMM is also based on system Verilog, OVM is also based on system Verilog, UVM is also based on system Verilog. Then what happened is it became a confusion. More than any benefit, it at one point it becomes a confusion, right? With so many methodologies, okay, but we have only one industry, VLSI industry, right? With so many methodologies, which one should people use, right? So that is where then all these three major companies, that is Mentor Graphics, Synopsys, and Cadence, together came and developed one methodology, what we call as Universal Verification Methodology. So we can easily say it is a superset of all methodologies. It is a superset of all the methodologies. And it has got concepts taken from every methodology for that matter. I mean, it has got a lot of things taken from ERM, RVM. You take any methodology, they have been taken from these methodologies. And one more thing you need to remember is UVM is an open source methodology. What does it mean by that? Users can view the code. For example, I will have an open source code like this. This is downloaded from Accelera web page. Accelera is one of the group which standardizes the UVM. You can download this source code. You can go to any code and you can view the files. Let's say you want to see how the agent code looks like. You can just open this code. You can see it has been developed by Mentor Graphics, Cadence, and Synopsys together. And you can see their code also, what code has been done. Like this, you can go to any of these classes and see what has been implemented in each and every file. Hence, we call this methodology as open source. It is developed in collaboration by Mentor, Synopsys, and Cadence. UVM can be used with any of the simulation tools. Since it is developed by all these three companies, they would have made sure that their simulators are compatible with UVM-based test benches. Do you have any questions with this slide? So in summary, what is UVM? UVM is a methodology that has been developed to make sure that to utilize, since there are a lot of similarities, since all test benches have a lot of things in common, we don't want to do everything from scratch. UVM provides base class implementations and some utility classes which can be used to reduce the overall test bench development time. What does it mean? Let's say if you develop a test bench using Verilog based test bench, using Verilog, let's say it takes 6 months time. Let's say if you use system Verilog to do, let's say it takes 4 months time. UVM based test bench may take only 3 months time, because in system Verilog, all the test bench components, transactions, everything has to be have to be developed from scratch. For example, I have to code AXI BFM end class, everything from scratch, all the code from scratch. Whereas in UVM, to develop the same component, I have a concept called as base class UVM driver, where you pass AXI transaction as parameter. No need of developing from scratch. Lot of things are already implemented in UVM driver. Only implement things specific to AXI protocol. Understand the concept? Since it gives me the base class UVM driver, I don't need to implement everything from scratch. Lot of things are already implemented in UVM driver. Only you need to implement things which are specific to AXI protocol. That is where the UVM reduces the overall time taken to set up the test bench. Like what it was taking 4 months, now it will only take 3 months. If given these options, which one I would go with? Of course, I would go with UVM based test bench, right? That is where you see industry is moving towards methodology driven verification. I mean, I won't say UVM driven verification, because there could be still companies who may be using VMM, who may be still using OVM. But at least 90% of the industry has moved to UVM. Another thing is, once you learn a methodology, once you learn UVM, learning OVM is one day task, because 95% of things are common, 5% differ, may differ. But then with the new revisions of these methodologies, they implement that 5% difference also. Hence, all methodologies will be almost same. Hence, all methodologies will have almost same features, except naming difference. What does it mean is, let me tell you. If you take a methodology like UVM 1.2, for example, this is one of the version. Let's say you take VMM 2.6. See, this 1.2 and 2.6 should not be confused, because VMM has a different revisions and UVM has a different revision. Let us say VMM 2.6 implements 95% of the UVM 1.2. Now what they do is, when they go to next revision 2.7, they will implement remaining 5% also. They will make it 100%, because anyway UVM is open source. You can see everything that has been done in UVM. What they will do, they will improve their code, their base classes, their macros, utility classes, to implement all the things of UVM. Please note, UVM and VMM is only for reference purpose. I mean, it can happen reverse also, where UVM may be taking VMM features and VMM may be taking UVM features. At the end, what will happen is, if you take the most latest version of UVM, VMM or OVM or anything, they will almost have the same features. They try to make sure that they take all the features of other methodology and make their methodology as industry relevant as possible. Hence, you learn UVM, you learn OVM, you learn VMM, it doesn't matter. You will be learning the almost same concepts in all the methodologies. But since industry asks specifically UVM, it is good to focus on UVM to start with. But as I said, once you learn UVM, you can learn any other methodology in very short time. Now, what is the need for methodology? It is developed, basically, let's say we develop test bench for different designs. Designs could be like USB controller, DMA controller, memory controller, or keyboard controller. Any design you take, just for example. There are a lot of things common in all these test benches. There are a lot of things common in all these test benches. What does methodology do is, methodology brings uniformity into the complete verification flow. I mean, the way we do the things, the way verification engineers do the things. What methodology does, it brings uniformity into complete verification flow. That is the way verification engineers do the things. It brings uniformity into that. So basically, methodology implements everything that user wants. Everything user can think of in functional verification flow. For example, test bench architecture definition. My methodology UVM will tell me how a test bench architecture should look like. Test bench component coding. Methodology will tell me how to code test bench components. Methodology will tell me how test cases should be coded. And methodology will tell how scenarios should be developed. Methodology will tell me how to print various types of messages. And it will tell me when to end the test. It will tell me how to report the test status. It will tell me how to connect the components, how to check the design outputs. I mean, anything that you want to do in test bench, these are only some 10 items I have listed, 9 or 10 items. You can list down another 20 items. Methodology will tell me how to do each and everything. So for to understand this example, this concept, we will use AHB interconnect as a reference design to understand these concepts. So let us start with AHB interconnect. Design understanding. Can you please take a look at this diagram once? I will ask one of you to explain this design.
So what is config block?
Let me tell you. Okay. Basically, what is interconnect is, let's just go to Google and search once. I'll show you what is interconnect. AHB interconnect diagram. Rather this example. Okay. If you take this kind of design, for example, my SoC typically consists of many components. Let me give you an AHB interconnect overview. Okay. Most of the designs in currently are based on ARM processors. I mean, most of the designs these days use ARM processors because ARM processors give higher performance. They are risk-based processors used for portable devices. Portable device means what? Mobile phones, those kind of devices. Portable devices. They give higher performance with minimal power consumption. Hence, people prefer using ARM-based processors for portable device applications. ARM processors are multiple types. They are based on A series, M series, R series. Different series will be there. Irrespective of this, all these processors have work only on two kinds of interfaces. Two types of interfaces. That is AXI, AHP. Now AXI, these protocols in turn have multiple generations. In turn have different generations. Like you can call a example AXI 3.0, AXI 4.0, AS, Qi, different protocol. AHP can have AHP 2.0, AHP 5.0. Different generations can be there. But irrespective of that, they can majorly classify it into two categories, AXI protocol, AHP protocol. That means if you go to market and purchase any processor, or rather you don't go to market, you go to ARM company and purchase any processor, it will be either based on AXI, it will be either based on AHP. What does it mean is, if we take a processor which is A series based, it will use AXI interface. M and R series processors use AHP interface. A stands for application. M stands for embedded, I guess. I mean, I'm not sure, but these are used for embedded applications. R is for real series. Okay. Generally, application series processors require very high performance requirements, whereas embedded and real series processors, they don't require very high performance. Hence, for high performance, you go with AXI protocol. For medium performance, you go with AHP protocol. That is how they classify. If I use A series based processor in my design, when would I use a design which requires very high performance? In those cases, I go for A series. It needs to be connected into AXI interconnect. What is interconnect here is some kind of design module into which you can connect a Cortex A series processor, all other components which work on AXI protocol. They will be working on AXI protocol. This can be USB, this can be display. You take any protocol, this is A series processor, ARM processor. Different components. Basically, interconnects connect multiple masters to multiple slaves using this common interconnect module. In summary, what is it? Interconnects are used for connecting multiple masters. Masters can be processors or DMA controllers to multiple slaves. What interconnect does is when a transaction comes, when a transaction comes in this direction, it will figure out to which slave it is targeted to, whether it is in this direction, whether it is in this direction, where it is, figure out. That is what intelligence interconnect has. And the request goes in this direction. And USB intern will talk to the USB pen drive. It will get the response from pen drive and it will send back the response to the processor. This is how typically it works. The role of interconnect is basically to connect ARM processor to USB, ARM processor to display block, ARM processor to keyboard controller, ARM processor to DMA controller, different components. Now the next question comes, what if my design is based on one of, I'm using one of the components, let's say keyboard controller. It is a low performance design. It doesn't need AX interface. Then how can I connect that? That is where comes a concept called as bridge protocol, which will be converting AXI to APB. Then I will be connecting it here. I will have one more interconnect. Now this interconnect will be APB interconnect. Please note, earlier interconnect was AXI interconnect. Now this will be APB interconnect. Here I will connect my keyboard controller, SPI controller, I2C controller. So we categorize the design subcomponents into two categories majorly. High performance components, low performance component. Even further, you can classify high performance, medium performance, low performance. Let us say there is one design which needs to work on AHB protocol, or there are three designs which need to work on AHB protocol. I am going to pull one more interconnect, one more bridge, which will do AXI to AHB conversion, and it will go and connect to one more interconnect. This we call as AHB interconnect. In this, we'll connect the corresponding blocks which are AHB based. If I take this design example, can someone tell me how many interconnects are there in this design? Can someone tell me? I want this session to be interactive. I am not in a classroom. So if you make it interactive, I will be able to share more details.
There is only one interconnect, I guess. Total there are three interconnects.
Yeah, the example we have taken has three interconnects. All the components which work on AXI protocol will connect to AXI interconnect. All the components which work on AHB protocol will connect to AHB interconnect. All the components which are based on APB protocol will connect to APB protocol. Now there is no compulsion that a design must have all the three interconnects. You can only have a design which has got only AXI interconnect. You can have a design where AHB and AXI is there. Any combination is possible. Tomorrow you may introduce, instead of AHB, you may introduce wishbone protocol, for example. In that case, you have to use AXI to wishbone bridge. This will be wishbone interconnect. Now we will come back to our original discussion where we were talking about what is an interconnect. I hope by now you understood what is an interconnect. Interconnect is used for connecting multiple masters to multiple slaves. Because interconnect is a module, is a design module, it needs to be configured.
Sir, when is
parameters? I'll answer one. Just give me a minute. Some parameters like slave starting and ending addresses, starting address, slaves, ending address. This configuration of above addresses is done using config interface. That is why we need config block. In our example, AHB master is like a processor. AHB master 2 is another processor. AHB slave 1 is a USB controller. AHB slave 2 is a DMA controller. AHB slave 3 is a memory controller. To configure the slave behavior, we use config block. Yeah, someone had a question now.
AHB protocol used, like for keyboard, we use APB.
Come again. I didn't get your question.
So when is AHB protocol used, like APB is used for keyboard?
I have already told you, right? AHB used where there is medium application. For example, you have a washing machine. In a washing machine, a small microcontroller will be there. M series microcontroller will be there. So there it will be based on AHB protocol.
ASB, sir. ASB.
ASB. ASB is not used now. Mostly industry has moved to AHB. Okay. So let us understand this reference design, AHB interconnect now. AHB interconnect connects multiple masters to multiple slaves. Some of you may be thinking why we are moving from UVM to AHB. I am introducing AHB interconnect. Through that, we will learn how UVM is useful, why we are using UVM. We are taking this reference design example for that purpose. So now let us understand what is AHB interconnect. AHB interconnect connects multiple masters to multiple slaves. It is parameterizable, means parameterizable for number of master interfaces and slave interfaces. It is parameterizable for how many master interface you need, how many slave interface you need. In summary, in very basic analogy, interconnect is similar to post office in real life analogy. See, lot of posts come from one different set of people, and post office categorizes them and sends them in to the destinations. When the response or acknowledgement comes from the person who is receiving the post, they will send it back to the original person who actually initiated that post. For example, money order is initiated. It goes to post office. It goes to the recipient. Then recipient further gives the acknowledgement. Acknowledgement. It goes to post office. Then it goes to the sender. You will say. So basically, post office is acting like a place which routes the incoming requests and incoming responses to the different recipients and senders. Interconnect also does the same thing. Interconnect gets requests from various components. Most these will always be masters, always be called as masters. Figures out to which slave it is targeted to. Sends the request to that slave. Interconnect gets response from various components, always be called as slaves. Figures out to which master it is targeted to, sends response to that master. The complexity comes. Why it gets complex? How it gets complex? With many masters and slaves doing transactions at same time, things get difficult, things get complex. That is what you will understand when you go to AHB protocol. Right now, this is not the session where we are going to understand how things get complex, how this. So when we go to AHP protocol, we'll understand how my AHP master, AHP interconnect is going to handle lot of transactions happening at the same time. I mean, how, what is the protocol suggest in those cases? That we'll understand. Now let us come back to this thing. So when I say parameterizable for number of master interface and number of slave interface, what I mean by that is, in this design, I have two masters. I can have one more interconnect where there are four masters and three slaves. Where I have three masters and five slaves, I can change that. That is what I mean by parameterizable for number of master interfaces and slave interfaces. Design is configurable for number of masters and slave interfaces. Only one master can do transactions at any point of time. That is the AHP protocol. That is how AHP protocol works. Arbitration phase is used with the arbiter inside interconnect, giving grant to a master based on its priority order. Once a master gets priority, it starts doing transfers. Interconnect uses address mapping to decide which slave is being targeted. Transaction is driven to that slave. Slave address space is configurable through the config interface. So we'll use config interface to configure the slave address range. Rather than saying space, I will say slave address range. Each slave address range can be configured using APB interface. That is where you need this interface. So we have a design which has got multiple master interfaces, multiple slave interfaces, one configuration interface. What is this AHP master refers to? AHP master represents processor or DMA controller in SOC. Because DMA controller also can act like a master in the system. What does it do? It generates writes and reads targeting different slaves. What is AHP slave? Represents various controllers in SOC. What are the various controllers? For example, USB controller, DMA controller. For example, in this case, I wouldn't call DMA because I called it as master. Let's say keyboard controller or memory controller. You take any example like this. They all represent the slaves. What do they do basically? The request comes from the processor to these controllers. It responds back to those requests. Response to write read request from the master. That is the slave does. So in this diagram, this would have been represented by processors. These would have been represented by USB controller, a keyboard controller, memory controller, PCI Express controller, different components like that. This would be represented through APB interface because you need to only program the registers. You don't need any complex features. So you go with a simple protocol for this interface. Now, given that this is our design, what will be my test bench requirements? Test bench structure should be configurable for parameterizable number of masters and slaves. I mean, if the design has variable number of masters and slave, my test bench also should have variable number of master and slave environments. I hope you understood, right? I mean, as the design interfaces changes, my test bench structure also should change. That is what I meant by saying configurable. Next point, DUT, in this case, AHP interconnect, should be configured for slave address range before master generates the transactions. What it means to say is, before I can generate any transaction, my APB should have done the configuration. Only then I can send the transactions. So if I tell like this, these are the things I need to do. These are the things I need to do. This should be done first, then only this should happen. Before doing this programming of the design registers, I should not generate traffic. Then it will go to wrong directions. Analogy is simple. You take a post office, unless you have assigned pin codes to different places in country, you can't send posts. So this is basically configuring those pin codes, which state is from where to where. This is generating the posts. So the role of config block is what? Programming the pin codes. Like Bangalore is from 5600 to this range. Mysore is from here to here. AHP is about people sending the posts. Which one should be done first? program, I mean, setting the pin code should be done first, then sending the POST. So in design example, it is similar to telling what is the start address range of slave, what is the end address range of slave, what is the start address of slave 2, what is the end address of slave 2, that will be programmed here. Then you generate the transactions. Okay. Next, reference model should mimic the DUT behavior to check the DUT behavior and how it is handling transactions. Basically, no need of arms. We need a reference model should mimic the DUT behavior. It is used for checking purpose, used for checking the design behavior. Next, reporting of messages should be clean and it should give clear information on which master is generating request and which slave is responding. So we should have more messages and it should give a very clean report who is doing the transaction now, which slave is responding, all that. Next point, test bench should have option to change the individual component behavior for following. We should be able to create error scenarios, we should be able to enable coverage collections. Like that, a test bench can have various types of requirements. If I summarize all these requirements and I come up with a procedure for developing a test bench, the various items that goes into test bench component and object coding will be this list. Can you please go through this list once, everyone?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, please tell me.
I think this line is wrong. Third line, sir. Connecting BFM to generator using mailbox. Generator to BFM, no, sir?
Generally, we connect BFM to.
Generator to BFM, sir.
It doesn't matter, right? I mean, whether you say BFM to generator or generator to BFM. Both are same only, but if you want it to be technically, then please go through. So I'm sure you should be familiar with this. Since you would have done projects based on system log, you would be able to correlate with what I have written here. My test bench should basically have BFM monitor generator coverage coded for AHB APB interfaces. You connect generator to BFM using mailbox, connect monitor to coverage and reference model using mailbox. And we should develop reference model, we should develop register model. BFM monitor generator and coverage are enclosed in sub environment class. We call them as APB environment and AHB environment. APB environment and AHB environment, reference model, register model, instantiated in top environment. Separate class is not required. It is already understood to be a class. Top environment instantiated in program block. The program block instantiated in topmost module. And interface is what we call this as test bench top module. Interface is passed to BFM monitors through function new arguments. Writing, and what is other requirement? Writing scenario for each interface for different required features. Writing test cases. I mean, we have to develop these concepts, these things also. Then we should be able to control the order of flow of transactions at APB and AHB interface. I told you, right? First APB transaction should happen, then AHB transaction should happen. We should have control on that. And we should be displaying messages during the test case run. Displaying test case simulation flow, like first what is happening, reset is happening, then configuration of registers is happening, then we are running the simulation. Then we are checking the output. So we should be able to define that.
Sir, no audio.
Hello. Yeah, your voice is not audible.
For these four set of things, for doing these four set of things, UVM provides base classes. For developing register model, there is some register abstraction layer base classes for register model coding.
Sir, can you please repeat for 2-3 minutes? We had no audio.
You didn't have audio. Okay. Now, is it good?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. So, what I was telling is, I hope you understood S-Bench coding requirements using System Verilog. Is everyone clear with these requirements? Okay. Now, whatever I have listed here, if I do the same thing using UVM, we are trying to understand how UVM helps with that. For developing the test bench components, UVM provides base classes, which can be used to implement the components. Okay. We don't need to, the point is we don't need to do everything from scratch. The base classes, base class example is like UVM driver, UVM monitor, UVM sequencer, UVM environment, etc. They already have lot of common functionality, all the common things implemented, For example, AHB driver. If you want to implement AHB driver, we don't need to. To implement AHB driver, all I have to do is class AHB driver extends UVM driver. In the transaction, you pass AHB transaction as a parameter. We only have to code some AHB specific functionality here. Let's say to code AHB monitor, we have to write AHB monitor extends UVM monitor. So to develop anything, right, even to develop a transaction, let's say to develop AHB transaction, it comes with a base class called as UVM sequence item. Using these base classes, which are already implemented, we can easily develop our required components with minimal effort. That is where we save a lot of time. Now, for connecting components to each other, for connecting components to each other. UVM provides with PLM base classes. For writing scenario for required features, UVM provides with UVM sequence related base classes, which can be used to develop the sequences easily. Like that, for every requirement, controlling the order of flow of transactions, for example, this one, UVM provides virtual sequencer, virtual sequences to do this. Next, defining the messages during, displaying the messages during the test case run. For that, there are some UVM message based classes out there, which makes the message reporting very easy. Okay, which makes the message reporting very easy. As we go forward, we'll talk about all these message classes and everything. Defining the test case simulation flow. What UVM does is, UVM gives a very clear guidelines on how simulation should be run. First, you should run build phase. Then we should run connect phase. Then we should run end of elaboration phase. Then we should run startup simulation phase, run phase, extract phase, check phase, report phase. Basically, UVM is nothing but is lot of base classes, lot of macros. It is system verilog macros. In system verilog, you would have studied the concept of macros, the same macros I'm talking about here. And guidelines, many set of guidelines on how to do everything of a test page. What does it mean by, what does this line mean? Set of guidelines on how to do everything of test bench. What does it mean by that is? For example, this is what I want to do in the test bench. Come up with the test bench architecture. UVM will clearly tell me how my test bench architecture should look like. Let's say I want to code the test bench components. My UVM will have a set of rules or guidelines which will tell me how test bench should be coded. Let's say coding test cases, my UVM will clearly tell me how test case should be coded. In summary, anything that you want to do in the test bench, there will be guidelines for that. What it does is, every verification engineer will follow same set of guidelines. Hence, all UVM based test benches will follow, will have similar structure and flow. It becomes easy for a new verification engineer to ramp up on existing UVM test bench. This is not true in case of system verilog test benches, because in system verilog test bench, there is no guarantee that if I join a project which is based on system verilog, there is no specific guideline. System verilog test benches can be developed in any way you want. It will take more effort for me to ramp up on system verilog test bench. Whereas for a UVM test bench, it doesn't take any effort because I know this is where test case will be present. This is where my BFM, this is how driver will be coded. This is where my test cases will be present. This is where my checkers will be present. Everything is very well defined. That is because of this set of guidelines. Along with that, UVM is basically a lot of base classes and macros. Hence, for all these reasons, industry is moving to UVM. If I develop a UVM based test bench architecture for AHP interconnect. This is how it will look like. First of all, you would start with topmost module. Below topmost module, I have an environment class. UVM based test bench for AHP interconnect. It will have top module. Below top module, we'll have something called as top. Don't confuse top with top module. It is instance of UVM root. Below UVM root, test case will be there. Test case instantiated as UVM test top. Below test case, AHP interconnect environment will be there. Below this, AHP master environment, AHP slave environment, APP environment. Below this, AHP master agent, AHP slave agent, APP agent. Below these components, I'll have AHP driver, AHP sequencer, AHP monitor, AHP coverage. And parallel to this, of course, I'll have AHP interconnect scoreboard, AHP interconnect checker, all these things will be there. This is how my structure will look like in UVM based methodology. First thing you notice is there is no program. UVM based test benches don't have any program block. Program block is replaced by UVM root instance. As we go forward, we'll understand more in depth about all these aspects. That is what you see in this diagram. Top module, then there will be an environment class here. Root, below root, there will be top environment. Below that, AHP master environment, AHP slave environment, APB environment. Below that, agents will be there. Below agent, driver, monitor, sequence, coverage, they will be there. This is how it looks like. Overall, if you see, AHP master and slave agents are instantiated in AHP environment, APB agent instantiated in APB environment, AHP and APB environment scoreboard instantiated in top level environment, top level environment instantiated in test, test is instantiated in topmost module. So which is similar to the structure that we have discussed. So I will be sharing these notes with you. Please go through this structure, and if you have any doubts, we can discuss again in the tomorrow's session. I hope by now you should have understood why we need a methodology. Did you understood why we need a methodology? Methodology is required because there are a lot of things in common. Now let us go to the next aspect where we will understand UVM overview. What is UVM basically? What consists of UVM? UVM is not a tool, not a compiler. First thing you need to remember is it is not a tool. It is not a compiler. It is set of following hundreds of base classes, many base classes. I would say lot of macros, at least 300 plus macros, many macros. Multiple utility based classes, what we call as factory, config db, resource db, etc. And guidelines on how to do each aspect of test bench coding, everything. How do we develop test case? How do we write test bench components? How do we connect them? How do we do complete test bench architecture? How do we code test cases and scenarios? How do we do test passing status? How do we check test passing status? How do we know whether test case is hanging? How to display messages? Any other requirement you can list down. Any questions you have? Now.
Yes, sir.
Because of my question. Yeah.
Right now we have like tens and tens of deep hierarchies in our design.
Yeah, so let's say I have one adder which is in let's say 10 hierarchies deep down my SOC. So now if I need to verify at that level, even then I will need all these classes and macros versus when I am doing from the very top level. So like, let's say there is one component, like just an adder, and I need to verify it using, let's say, OVM and all these things. Yeah. And then again, I am doing the same thing from the top level. So like, where would the differences lie?
Whatever you are calling, that is called as chip level verification. In that case, you still need to develop BFM generator, everything. I mean, all this driver sequencer, everything. But all those connections you will be doing at the top level, not at the adder level. From the top level, you will be generating transactions in such a way that those transactions will end up reaching full adder, that adder, and that adder will give you output that you will monitor and verify it. You will not do anything next to adder. You will be doing everything from the outside only, outside the chip. Did you understood?
Can you please repeat?
What I said is, if this is my chip, for example, let's say somewhere here adder is there. I can't set up a test bench here. Test bench will not come here. Test bench will be set up here only for this interface. Okay. You will be driving it so that the transactions will reach adder, and whatever output comes, you will collect here. These two will not be there. These will be the real design components. You will be driving from here and you will be collecting here, and then you will be checking here by collecting the transactions.
Okay. And one thing more, let's say the inputs of these adder were driven by some logic, but in the verification environment, can this be bypassed? Just like we have like we scan flops, like can this be bypassed? Do we have direct control from the top? Like, can we directly post over them and not drive them?
Your question is very specific to design, right? So there is no generic answer for that. If design supports bypassing them, you will do that. Otherwise, you have to do from the main interface only. So to answer your question, it is design specific.
Okay.
Next. Now, since as I said before, UVM is nothing but base classes. Okay. Hence, everything in UVM is implemented as a base class. What you need to understand is majority of things in UVM are implemented as base classes. Even printing messages is done using classes. Event is implemented as UVM event class. That what I'm trying to say is everything in UVM is a class. What is class is about? Class is about object-oriented programming. So hence we need to understand some basics about object-oriented programming. Let me again make it clear. I'm not going to get into what is object-oriented programming, what is inheritance, what is encapsulation, what is polymorphism. I'm not going to talk too much into it, because if you are learning UVM, you should be good with object-oriented programming basics. So we are going to understand why object-oriented programming concepts are essential for UVM. I mean, without this object-oriented programming, UVM would not be possible. That is what we are summarizing. So in summary, what is object-oriented programming? Encapsulation, inheritance, polymorphism, static methods and static properties, parameterized classes, parameterized macros, and abstract classes. You can say, even though when you study object-oriented programming, people say these are the only three things. But we can just extend them with some more minor things like static methods and static properties, parameterized classes, parameterized macros, abstract classes. All above object-oriented programming concepts are essential for efficient implementation of UVM libraries. When I say libraries, UVM-based classes and macros. To implement them, these concepts are very important. If these concepts were not there, UVM would not be possible.
I mean, if above UVM, if above object-oriented programming concepts were not there, if any, rather than saying above, any of above concepts were not there, UVM would not be so efficient, would not be so much efficient. Focus is only on understanding why OOP is essential for UVM to work, the way it works. Course will not cover object-oriented programming in depth. We are not going to get into what is inheritance, what is polymorphism. We are just going to understand a quick overview of polymorphism, how it relates to the UVM. To understand this, we need to first understand the UVM base class hierarchy. Please take a look at this diagram. I'll give you some conventions in this diagram. This represents inheritance. In this case, can someone tell me which class is inherited from which class? UVM report object is inherited from UVM object. UVM component is inherited from UVM report object. UVM monitor is inherited from UVM component. That's what we understand. What does this indicate? This symbol, rhombus shaped, thick rhombus shaped thing and line. What does it indicate? It indicates that report handler is instantiated in report object. Yeah, report handler is instantiated in report object, it indicates. And now, given this base class hierarchy, so what are the UVM base class are used for? From this hierarchy, what can we see? UVM base class are used for creating test bench components, that is these things. UVM driver, UVM monitor, UVM scoreboard, UVM agent, these are all used for developing the test bench components. And these base classes, TLM54, TL implementation port, export, these are used for connecting test bench components. Then there is another set of base classes which are used for creating test scenario. Okay, rather than calling stimulus, test scenario. And another set of base classes which are used for reporting the messages. That is reporting classes, report object, report handler, report server. Then you have set of utility and databases. Then you have synchronization of test bench process. I mean, base classes which are used for synchronization of test bench process. Then base classes which are used for developing register layer components. So given this base classes, this is the inheritance relation, how they are related to each other. Now let us understand what is encapsulation. Encapsulation is basically grouping together properties and methods into a single entity with methods operating on properties. We will discuss what is report handle as we go forward. What does encapsulation do? It provides a sense of protection to properties, methods by declaring local and protected. You can declare properties as local and protected, and you can make sure that outside components won't access those properties. UVM object, for example, what is in encapsulation here? If I take UVM object, field is name, methods are copy, clone, and print. So these method copy, clone, and print will work on the variable name. So this is what we mean by encapsulation. Next, what is inheritance? Inheritance promotes reusability across UVM base classes. UVM implements all the component base functionality as in various base classes, as different base classes, I will say. The properties methods declared in UVM object automatically become part of UVM report object. Whatever properties and methods declared in UVM object automatically become part of UVM report object due to inheritance relation. What does this inheritance helps is, helps user avoid recoding all of recoding of the methods defined in base classes in derived classes. So user don't need to re-implement all the base class methods. Because of inheritance, these base class methods automatically become part of the derived class. It also helps with proper organization of the code across various base classes. See, otherwise what would have happened is, this report object methods, this copy, clone, print methods, would we need to code again if there was no concept of inheritance. Now what you do is, whatever is corresponding to UVM object, you only keep those things with that. It requires name and different methods. Let's say next you need report object. It requires some fields and some methods. You only code this thing. But since it is inherited from UVM object, everything here, that is all these methods, automatically become part of this class. Now, whereas if you take component, all these methods, all of them become part of UVM component. Whereas if you take monitor, all these methods, all these methods, all these methods, all of them become part of UVM monitor or UVM scoreboard or UVM agent, UVM driver. So UVM monitor doesn't need to implement clone again. It is already there for it. UVM monitor don't need to implement build and connect end of elaboration methods because they are already automatically part of all these classes. I hope you understood this. This is why inheritance is essential in UVM. I mean, only because of inheritance we are able to come up with this kind of structured base class hierarchy. Polymorphism. What is polymorphism? Object definition to be used is decided at the runtime. UVM implements most of the base class tasks and functions as virtual. User can override and overridden definition can be used during the execution. I mean, polymorphism also gets used in many places during the test bench, during the UVM implementation. And what it indicates is UVM widely implements the concept of polymorphism during its base class development. UVM widely uses polymorphism concept during its base class, during the base class development. Similarly, static properties and static methods. People who have attended system Verilog training in our institute know how we use static properties and static methods in test bench development. What does these static properties and static methods do? They provide concept of shared pool of variables. A property's memory is created with class definition, and these properties can be used across the test bench by using scope resolution operator. Let's say I have something called as Ethernet config class. Let's say the static property name is count, transaction count. I can use this variable. This can be used anywhere in the test bench to refer to this static variable. So transaction count is declared static property, static variable in ETH config class. UVM important concepts like factory, resource database, config database majorly use static properties and methods for their implementation. Without this static property and methods, this factory and resource DB, config DB would not be possible. In summary, what? Without this concept of static properties and static methods, factory, it would not be possible to implement concept of possible to implement factory, resource DB, and config DB. You can't implement them because it is very important. This concept of static properties and methods are very important in UEM. Do you have any questions till this point? Next, parameterized classes. What parameterized classes does this?
Sir, I have
a... Yeah.
But that is related to this UVM. So let's say I am, there is a communication between, let's say, my processor to, let's say, my any controller, keyboard controller, like processor will be the master and the keyboard will be the slave.
Yeah.
So let's say now I am only and only verifying my keyboard IP.
Yeah.
But for that keyboard IP, there will be like, it's a memory map device, there will be slaves in it. But now when I'm verifying, will my whole of the test bench environment will act as a master to it?
See, again, we need to understand whether you are going to do SOC verification or whether you are going to block level verification. So
block
my
level.
Answer. So if you are doing block level, you have to replace everything of the design and replace it with BFM and generators.
Okay, so whole of the master will be like replicated by the BFMs.
Yes.
And NOX will be, interconnect will be there.
Interconnect will not be there. Everything okay. will be replaced by.
Yeah, yeah, okay, okay. So we'll have to mimic the interconnect also.
Yes.
Okay, okay, okay. Fine.
So let us come back to the our original discussion, parameterized classes. What is the benefit of parameterized classes? They provide reusability of classes. I mean, they helps with the reusability of the classes. System Verilog supports both type and value parameterization. UVM implements a lot of base classes as parameterized classes so that they can be reused for various type and value parameterization. Let me tell you how value parameterization is useful. Okay, for example, if I take AXI driver code, all I have to do is class AXI driver extends UVM driver in the parameter AXI transaction end class and some AXI specific coding, AXI specific coding. If I take AHB driver, you will just change it to AHB. This will be same. Here you'll use AHB transaction and here you will do AHB specific coding. This above is possible. Above is possible only if UVM driver is a parameterized class. If not, we have to implement everything from scratch. That is where parameterized classes are very important in UVM. If there was no concept of parameterized classes, you can't do it. Now, what is parameter is here? AHB transaction is the parameter here for AHB driver. AXI transaction is the parameter for AXI driver. So what does parameter will do? All my code will be replaced with AXI driver wherever that parameter is there. All T parameters, sorry, all REQ parameters will be replaced with AXI TX. Here also, all REQ parameters will be replaced with AHB TX. That is how same UVM driver code will get deferred for AXI, will get deferred for AHB based on what parameter you pass. Hence, parameterized classes are very important for UVM to work. So parameterized classes are very important for UVM to work. Efficiently. Are you getting the point? Just by changing the parameter, I'm able to get the code which gets updated for AXITX. In this case, code gets updated for AHBTX. Accordingly, I can get different functionalities. Next, parameterized
macros.
Yeah.
question here. So in the previous slide, parameter which you are passing, that is a class instance, and for what is exactly we are trying to pass? Like with AX,
what I'm trying to pass. So I will show you that in that case. If you go here, you go to the driver components, you go to UVM driver. This UVM driver is a parameterized class. Okay. This has got two parameters, REQ, RSP. When I pass the UVM driver here with AXITX, REQ will take AXITX. Because second argument is nothing but REQ only, RSP equal to REQ. If you don't pass anything, it will take REQ. So both REQ and RSP will be what? Can you tell me? AXITX. Wherever request is there, wherever REQ is there, it will get replaced with AXITX.
So that is nothing but a handle only, right? So that is a instance name only, basically.
Instance.
Right? So whenever you are requesting something.
Understand, it's not instance name, it is the parameter type variable. All the code gets updated as if it is working for AXITX. Earlier it was working for generic request and response. There was nothing specific. Now when I replace this with again AXITX, the code now became specific to AXI code, this whole code. Now instead of this, if I change it to AHP, for example, if I pass AHP, the code will become generic to AHP, AHPTX. This concept is possible only because we have developed a parameterized class. If you don't have parameterized class, I have to manually do this. Now I don't have to do all these things manually. These all things happen just by concept of passing parameter itself. Did you understood?
Yeah.
Similar is the use with parameterized macros. Macros with arguments. I mean, macros with arguments are widely used in, are widely implemented in UVM. Macros with arguments provides, so same macro can be used for different requirements. What does they provide? They do is, it provides flexibility to reuse same macro for different requirements. That is what macros with arguments will do. Okay, for example, I'll just give you an example here. We use something called as UVM component utils AXI monitor. This code is used above line registers AXI monitor to the factory definition. If I want to register AXI driver, all I have to do is AXI driver. That's all. This is called as a parameterized macro. So in above code, is the parameterized macro. Using the same parameterized macro, we are able to reuse the same macro for different requirements. That is why parameterized macros are important for UVM. Widely used across UVM test bench coding, object component registration to the factory, what you see here, reporting classes, reporting macros, user defined DLM classes, many places they get used. I hope you understood. In last 10 to 15 minutes, I didn't try to teach you what is object-oriented programming. I tried to just teach you why these object-oriented programming's are concepts are important for UVM. Without this parameterized macro, UVM would not be so efficient. Without concept of parameterized class, UVM will not be possible. Without concept of static properties and methods, it's not possible. So all these object-oriented programmings are very essential for UVM to work efficiently. Next, we'll go to the next concept where we'll understand UVM test bench architecture. So far we have understood what is UVM, why we need UVM methodology, what is UVM overview, object-oriented programming basics. Now we'll go to the next concept, UVM test bench architecture. Once we have done with this, we'll take a break. How does UVM test bench architecture look? Every test bench requires some configuration parameters for changing the test bench behavior for different test cases and different design configurations. Please read this once. This is a bit complex. Just read it. I will explain. This will help us understand how UVM works essentially. So let's go through this now. Every test bench requires some configuration parameters for changing the test bench behavior for different test cases and different design configuration requirements. Okay. UVM test bench, I will give you an example for this. You take example of memory controller. Memory controller, one test case. Memory controller has may have different requirements, may have different, may need different parameters, which memory to connect, how many transactions to do. Any specific feature we want to check, refresh, any specific what else you want to do? We have done this. Let's say introduce generate error scenarios. This all becomes different test case requirements and different design configuration requirements. What UVM test bench tells is, do not change these things in the, do not change these concepts in the, inside the file, inside the UVM test bench strongly discourages verification engineers from changing the test bench component parameters inside the same, inside that component. It should rather be done from top level configuration class or test case build phase. For example, we'll have something called as UVM config DB used for achieving this. Best example is, we want agent to behave like a active agent or passive agent, as a active agent or a passive agent. This does not require us to open agent class code and change the behavior. This can be done from either test case or configuration class. Let's read this again. We have an agent which can behave either like an active agent or passive agent. To make it behave like active or passive agent, I don't need to open the code and change the agent class code. Rather, I can do it from the test case or configuration class itself. This can be done from either test case or configuration class itself. I don't need to open the code. That is what UVM suggests. UVM test bench should be developed in such a way that all the test bench configuration should be done from one common file, also called as a class. That is either common configuration class or test bench build phase. You should not open the individual components and do the changes. That is the essence of UVM test bench architecture. Now, how does a UVM test bench architecture look like? Please take a look at this diagram once. So this diagram is very similar to what we have discussed earlier. You have a top module, that is top module, the black one. Then you have a top, which is UVM root instance, which they are calling as top level harness, whatever. Then below that you have a test case instantiated as UVM test top, that is test. Below test you have environment, top environment, which is environment. Below that you can have sub environments. I mean, if you don't want sub environment, you could directly keep agents, master agent and slave agent, coverage and scoreboard. That is scoreboard and checker. Like that, you can develop different components in the hierarchical order. Do you have any questions in this slide? Next, we'll go to the next aspect. Now we'll how test bench differs between system Verilog and UVM. Please go through this once. I will discuss the differences. So in system Verilog, you have a top module, below that you have a program block, below that you have top environment, below that sub environments, below sub environment you have BFM, generator, monitor and coverage, and in below top environment you have reference model and checkers, and if required you can have scoreboard. In UVM, program block is replaced with UVM root. Okay. It is called as top instance of UVM root essentially. Below top you have UVM test top. One major thing you should notice is in UVM, test case is also a component. Understand, in UVM, test case is also a component. Whereas in system Verilog, test case is a scenario. Or a task or a function. It is not a component. That is a very major difference between UVM and system Verilog test bench. Understand again, in UVM, test case is developed as a component. In system Verilog, test case is either scenario, task, or a function. Is either a class, task, or a function, but not a component. Then below this test top, top environment, it can have sub environments. Then you can have agents and all these things below it, and this would be this is below top environment only. Do you have any questions in this slide? Next, we'll move to some important aspects of, I think somewhere I have discussed the difference between SV and UVM. Where is it? Okay, let's list down the SV and UVM test bench differences. First difference is program block in SV is replaced with UVM root in UVM. Next, test case is a class, task, or a function. It's just a scenario in system Verilog. Whereas test case is a component with a specific structure in UVM. BFM in system Verilog is called as driver in UVM. Scenario generator in system Verilog is called as sequencer in UVM. Other than that, the system Verilog implements reference model and checker for checking the design behavior. Same thing, UVM implements all this in scoreboard and comparators. Essentially, scoreboard is nothing but a reference model. That's what it is. Okay. And SV implements coverage as a coverage class. In UVM, it is called as subscriber class. Like that, few differences are there. As we go forward, we'll understand. And ESV, all component connections are done using mailbox. UVM, component connections are done using PLM ports. So as we go forward, we'll list down more such differences. Now we will go to some important aspects of UVM. One very important aspect is a factory. First, let's understand what is a factory. Factory as an is an important concept in UVM. It is a singleton class instantiated in global class. What is singleton class means? Singleton class is one which has got only one instance in complete test bench. Only one instance in whole test bench. For example, if I write AXI TX, TX1, TX2, it is not a singleton because you have created two instances of AXI transaction. Hence, it is not a singleton class. There will be only one such instance in the complete test bench. Hence, UVM factory is called as singleton class. Factory is a global database of all component and object definitions, which can be accessed from any part of the test bench, and these definitions can be changed and updated as per the current test requirements. Let me give you an analogy, then we will understand what is factory. With that analogy, you will understand. Analogy. You take a medical factory. Medical factory manufactures tablets, ointments, and some syrups. Medical factory will have a server. Has a server where all these medicine definitions, formulas are registered. Registered means the formula is stored in the server. Now to generate 100 tablets, there are two ways. One is the same medicine has two definitions, has definition in two places. One is it definition on the paper, on paper definition. One is on server definition. Now to generate 100 tablets, to manufacture, rather than saying generate, manufacture 100 tablets, two ways are there. Use paper definition, use server definition. We prefer using server definition for following reasons. Server definition can be updated, and when we manufacture using server, we get medicines of latest formula. And server definition is accessible globally, can be accessed from anywhere in the world. Hence, it is easy to modify. And it is easy to know what changes have happened in generations. With different versions. Doing all these kind of benefits you don't get with paper definition. I mean, once you understand this analogy, you can understand the UVM factory also very easily. So first understand this concept. Medical factory generates tablets, ointments, syrups. So basically you have definition two places. One, first, before you put it into server, you develop the definition in a paper, right? Only then you store it into server. To manufacture 100 tablets, two ways are there. You either use paper definition or server definition. But we prefer using server definition because we get the latest definition, latest formula. It can be accessed from anywhere and you can easily modify the definition or modify or change anything you can do. Or modify or replace with new formula. Whatever you want to do, you can do it. Same, and it is easy to know what changes have happened from different versions. Same is the concept of factory in UVM. So I will take UVM factory now. I'll just replace it with UVM factory. Whatever we call as tablets, ointments, and syrup, they become UVM components. UVM objects. Factory has a server that what we call as UVM factory. It is a factory, that is what we are calling as UVM factory, where all these UVM components and UVM objects are registered into. Okay, now the formula means the definition, class definition is stored into the factory. Same medicine, same class has two definitions. On paper, it is similar to calling the system verilog file user has coded. The SV class definition that is registered into factory. Understand the analogy. Paper definition is like system verilog file definition. Server definition is like system verilog class definition that is registered into the factory. To manufacture 100 instances of of a component. Two ways are there. One is use SV file definition, use factory registered definition. We prefer using factory registered definition for following reasons. The factory registered definition can be updated and when we manufacturing using when we manufacture using factory definition using factory we get the we get object based on latest class definition, not the old one. Factory registered definition can be accessed from anywhere in the world. It's not world, anywhere in the test page. Hence, it is easy to modify and replace with the new definition. And it can be this definition update can be done on a test case, test specific basis. For one test case, I'll have one definition. For another test case, I'll have another definition. It is similar to telling the same medicine may have different formula in US, same medicine may have different formula in India. The same thing. I mean, I can have probably I can have different definition used in one test case, another definition used in another test case. And it is easy to know what changes have done in different versions of the component. That is where factory comes into picture. In summary, factory is a global database of all component and object definitions.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So for each test case, we can have a different database. It's like.
No. For whole test bench, one database will be there. With every test case you run, same database gets used. Okay. All test bench components and object definitions are registered into the factory. All config database updates happen into factory registered definitions. Now, what is config database? I'll explain you as we go forward. Right now, it's an advanced concept for you. All component and object creation happens based on latest definition updated into the factory. I told you, right? Whatever you create, it will be based on the factory definition, not on the SV file definition. SV file definition. Factory registration provides with various utility methods which make the coding very easy. Analogy is medical factory where all tablet syrup definitions are registered to common server. I think I have given you this example. So please go through this thing, you will understand it. Finally, you should be convinced that instead of using SV file definition, the definition that you have added into the factory is what is better. But then you may say, if that is the case, then why are we coding SV file itself? Next the question will come, if in above case, why should we code SV file itself? Tell me.
Because it is like each design specific. Once you code it, you have to register, then only you can use it.
Yeah, point is, without SV file definition, we can't register a definition to factory. So starting point is SV file only. Then only factory definition happens. So same thing with medical factory, right? Without paper definition, how can you create server definition? First, you put everything in paper. That definition, you put it in server. The benefit of server is it is easy to access and change the definition. Let's say server is in Bangalore. You are in Delhi. To change paper definition, you have to always go to Bangalore and change it. Whereas if it is in the server, you can do it anywhere in the world. The similar is the analogy with UVM factory. So we will take a break here. We will meet in 15 minutes. Then we'll continue with the remaining topics.
This conference will now be recorded.
Do you have any doubts, questions from whatever we have discussed so far? So till now, we have discussed what is UVM, what is the need for methodology, then UVM overview, object-oriented programming basics, then we have seen UVM test bench architecture, then we have also got a basic idea about what is factory. Now we will talk about, and we have also seen how SVU UVM test bench mapping works. Yes, program in SV is implemented as root in UVM, sub-environment implemented as agent, display messages is changed to UVM info, warning, error or fatal messages, generator becomes sequencer, BFM becomes driver, test is a task in system verilog, whereas test is a component in UVM, transaction or packet in system verilog is called as item in UVM, scenario or stimulus is called as sequence, mailbox in system verilog is replaced with TLM 1.0 or TLM 2.0 in UVM, new is replaced with create, dollar finish is user manually calls dollar finish in system verilog, whereas user not required, no need to call. UVM root will use objections to call dollar finish automatically. Next, then we have seen what is the factory. Factory is a very important concept. We'll discuss more about factory in the further sessions. Now let us develop a simple UVM test bench example. We will not take any design here, just to understand. Basically, this is to understand how to set up UVM test bench, how to run it using any simulator. In this case, we'll use Questa Sim in our example. What all things do we need? What all things do we need to set up UVM test bench? Primarily, you require to download UVM source code. The UVM source code can be downloaded from UVM Accelera. UVM, you just go and type Accelera, you go to this page, you get different generations of UVM, different standards of UVM. You can download any of these things, okay? A library code, what they're calling as. You can download any of them. Sometimes this UVM code is generic to the tool version. See, the 1.2 may not work with all the generations of QuestaSim. So accordingly, you need to choose which is the right version for you. And how to run it using any simulator is what we are going to understand. And we need to include this source code into our test bench compilation list. It's a very simple concept. I will just set up a simple example. You will understand. For that, let me just connect to the server and the first thing you need to do is we need to understand the structure. First, you need to have topmost module, this top module. So I'll go here, develop a file called as make dir ahb. I'll call it as template, ahb uvc template. Nothing, just a name I have given because we are going to further develop ahb only. So hence I gave a name, same name. I'll call it as top.sb. It is the top module. So since it is top module, I have to write module top end module. For any UVM based test bench to work, first thing you should do is you should include UVM package.sb. Whatever you download, right? UVM, for example, you go here, you go to here, go into the source. The first thing they provide is one file called as UVM package.sv. They always provide this file in all the UVM source codes. If you open this file, what you see is all the other things are included in this. See, it includes every other package. This is a package which has everything else included. Hence, including this package is as good as including everything else. Hence, if we include UVM package, everything gets included. And since it is a package, so what do you understand? If it is a package, what should I do along with including? See, it is a package. If I include a package, what else do I need to do for it to work? Can someone tell
me? Import.
I have to do
import package.
Import UVM package star. That means everything of UVM package becomes part of my test bench. I can use anything now, basically. That is the significance of importing UVM package. Okay, since it is done in the global scope, it will be available in the complete test bench. Since it is done in the global scope, it is available, all these definitions will be available anywhere in the test bench. The next thing I have to do is I have to define a test. As per my hierarchy, what is the thing? Below topmost module, top will be there, UVM root. This user don't need to do. It automatically happens in UVM. User not required. Okay. So I don't need to do. Only thing I have to do is define the test name. Class AHB base test. Extends. I told you that UVM provides a base class for everything. To define a test, UVM provides with a base test name called as UVM test. For monitor, UVM monitor. For driver, UVM underscore driver. For agent, UVM underscore agent. So remembering is very easy, right? For agent, UVM underscore agent. For test, UVM underscore test. Once you do this, what you have to do is register it to the factory. UVM component utils AHB base test. Along with this, we have to define function new string name UVM component parent end function. Okay, I'll just go and turn on the syntax. Super dot new name comma parent. As of now, we'll keep it this much only. We will not do anything more than this. Next, what is the other thing I have to do? Call the run test. I think in the top module, test definition and run test should be called. So I'll go here. I'll call something called as initial begin end. Call run underscore test. This completes the top module definition as of now. If you ask me, is it only the thing we do in top module? No, we do many other things. But given our example is only simple UVC template, HB UVC template, right now this much is sufficient for us. Now I can just run this example. Go here. So what you have to do? Create a run.do. How do you create run.do? Vlog top.sp vsim hyphen noviopt top run hyphen all. And just to check that this is working, what I will do is I'll create one more method called as build phase. Super dot, right now I'll not do that also. I'll use UVM info HB UVC test build phase UVM none. Do not get confused with all these things. Right now I will explain everything. As we go forward, I'll explain everything. This is how we print messages in UVM. You may be thinking it is more complex than dollar display. What is the whole point of then moving to UVM? I mean, if things are getting more complicated, why are we moving to UVM? Right now, it looks complicated to you, but as you develop this code for one or two times, you feel this is more easier than system Verilog. So now with this update, let us run this code. Sorry, we are, I think, in earlier folder. You have to change to this folder. Do run.do. Build phase has more arguments than method UVM component. Line number 12 has error. Line number 12. Build phase should have, right? I think void.
Sir, function void.
Yeah. Cannot open file. Yeah, see, we need to specifically give the source code. I mean, we haven't downloaded, right? See, whatever I have downloaded is outside my server. See, this server is different, my laptop is different. So I already have a project where I have done that. Earlier we have done some USB 2.0 verification using UVM. There already I have that source code. That is, go to verif this src. This SRC is the source code. So what I could do is copy RF SRC to two folders back. So it will come into my home path. I will use everything from this home path. Now you go to UVM, May, AHB, here itself. When you do this, you write plus INC DIR plus what is this path? It is under HTTP home srinu. This path under here, it is there. Copy this, just include that path. Now you run this. To run this again, you just go and do run that. Cannot find include file. Okay, and it is wrong because I have to give SRC also, because my file is present inside source. This package is present inside this path. If you ask me where is file present, it is present till SRC path. So I have to include till SRC, not only srinim, my path. So now it will find it. See, now compilation has gone through. Now elaboration is happening. Now simulation is running. There is a problem. This is related to some DPI. I won't go deep into it. What you have to do is when you run this code, right, you have to give some svlib path. You need to do some DPI mapping for that USB. USB verif sim verif in verif sim. Which path I have to take? Run.do. So just take this syntax. Only then it works.
So go here. What I'm doing is inside my Questa path, there is one DPI is there. That DPI also I have to elaborate. Then only it works. That there is some DPI mapping errors basically. You see, these are some DPI mapping errors. Fatal error at some DPI file, SV command DPI. Now when I use that SVlib, this error gets resolved. So even when you run from your side, you have to give this option compulsory. Now do run dot. So you should say don't finish the simulation, otherwise my tool will quit. You can go here, you can open this one, you can see the report. Fatal, no component instantiated. You must either instantiate at least one component before calling run test. So what is the mistake is, when you call run test, you have to pass which test you are running. I'm running AHB based test. So I have to tell, I'm telling to the environment that telling to the UVM test bench to run AHB based test. As you want to run different test cases, you have to keep changing it. Now if I run it, this fatal error will not come. Say no. Now you go and check. That fatal error would have got resolved now. Fatal error, there is no fatal error now. It is now telling, it is printing a information. At what time? Zero time. What is that it's printing? Running test, AHB based test. And at zero time only, it is telling from UVM test stop, it is printing this message, build phase. So it gives you more display information than what you have done. See, if you go to this case, what is that you have written? Only test build phase you have written in HBVC. It gives you so much information. It is printing a UVM info. Line number, file name, top.sv, line number 13. If you go here, see, the message is coming from line number 13. That is what you see here, line number 13. And what time? Zero time. Did you write dollar time here? No, right? We didn't write percentage T dollar time. This message automatically comes, zero time. From where it is coming? UVM test stop. What is the ID? ID is HBUVC that comes here. What is the message? Test build phase. Test build phase. Like that it comes. Now if I want to develop the structure further, what is my structure will have? Top environment has sub environments, let's say. Let's say sub environments are, for example, AHB environment and APB environment. Just an example, okay? How do I do that? Go here. You have to instantiate. Below AHB base test, I have to instantiate AHB interconnect environment. AHB interconnect environment. I call it as environment. Below AHB, this need to be built in ENV. Typically in system Verilog, this is how we create a class. System Verilog style. Whereas UVM suggests, don't do this. Do using AHB interconnect environment, type ID, create. Let me increase the size. Create env this. This is creating using file definition. Creating using factory definition. Can you please read these two lines once? See, we have instantiated object class by name. You see, you may not be seeing underscore. When I increase the font, there is a problem. The underscore doesn't show up, but there is underscore here. and this is ENV. There are two styles. One is system verilog style, which is created using file definition. Another is creating using factory definition like this. What is the medical factory analogy? This would be like creating using paper definition. This would be using server definition to create. Which one will prefer, line number 15 or 16? Can someone tell me?
16.
Okay. Line number 16 is what we prefer. I mean, we prefer using factory definition to create, because any changes that have happened to AHP environment, interconnect environment, I'll pick the latest definition of the AHP interconnect environment. Next, function void build phase. Okay, now I can run this. If I run this, I will get a problem. What is the problem? I will run this. Can someone tell me what is the problem I will get if I run as it is now?
There is no HBIC environment class.
Yeah, we haven't defined HB interconnect environment class. We have just used it. Just using it doesn't create that class, right? So I have to define that class. So that I am going to do in different ways. env.s. AHB, IC, ENB. Now, can you tell me, can someone tell me what should be the base class?
UVM
environment, ENB, end class. What is the first thing I did after this line? I mean, what is the first thing after this I did? I checked, is there any base classes below it? Below environment, ideally speaking, AHB master ENB. Let me call it as HBNB and APBNB would be there, but right now I will not do it. We'll just to do as of now. I won't do. What is the next thing I did after that? Can someone tell me what is line number 8 I did in this example? What is line number 8? This is called as what?
Factory registration.
Registering AHB base test to the factory. It is similar to saying adding tablet formula to the server, to the medical factory server. Now you may ask, what is this macro? What all things happen? I don't worry all that. I just understand. I just know that if I use this line, this definition gets added into factory. Same thing I have to do. Basically, everything you create in UVM test bench need to be registered to the factory. Every user defined class.
Can you explain that function once?
One second. Every user defined class in UVM must be registered to the factory. The benefit is user can change the definition with from anywhere in the stage, and when object is created, latest definition is picked. Yes. Okay. This is called as, that line is called as factory registration. Yeah. Someone had a question. What function to define? Please tell.
A function new. So can you explain that code?
Yeah. What is function new is, I will be explaining this later, but now since this question came up, I'll explain this. Basically, I will give you a simple analogy for this to understand this. Analogy is, let's say 50 people in a family. In a combined family. Okay. It means if I tell name of each person and his or her father name. Okay. It would be possible to, is it possible to build, come up with complete family tree? Can someone tell me? For every person, all the 50 people, each person means all 50. Is it possible to come up with the family tree for the whole family?
No, we have to tell the relation.
No, right? I think father name should be sufficient, right? I mean, in a simple terms, it should be possible. I mean, here I'm assuming that you may ask, then you need to give mother name also. Okay, fine. Father and mother name. Okay. If I give this, is it possible to come up with the complete family tree?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, right. It is possible. So finally, it will come up something like this. One head of the family, you may have three kids. There could be two, there could be three, four, there could be different like this. It will come. My UVM test bench also looks like this one. My UVM test bench also looks like this only. This is what I'm calling as root or test top. UVM test top. This I'm calling as one environment, another environment, another environment, sub environment, or agent, another agent, agent, driver, sequencer, monitor, driver, sequencer, monitor, agent. But what is that we need to give for each of them is name and parent. If you could just give name and parent, I mean, what is the difference in this analogy is why this little differs. See, in case of here, we have to give both father, mother. Whereas in UVM, you don't have two parents. You have only one parent. I mean, every component has only one parent. Driver parent is in UVM. For driver, parent is agent. For agent, parent is sub-environment. For sub-environment, parent is top-environment. For top-environment, parent is UVM desktop. For UVM desktop, parent is root. So if you just give the name and parent, you can come up with this kind of complete family structure. Complete family structure. Same way, same similarly, in UVM, if we provide name and parent of each component we create in this bench, the UVM is automatically capable of building complete test bench tree similar to family tree. In UVM, if you just give a name and a parent of each component, that is what we are doing. For whatever component we are creating, we are giving a name to it. We are telling who is the parent of that. If you can do so, what you are telling is for AHP based test, what is the name? What is the parent? Who is the parent? Similarly, when you create this thing, ENV. See, when you are creating ENV, you are telling that, please be in mute if you don't have questions.
Srinivas, I have a question here.
Yeah.
As this new functions, as you are saying, name and parent are somehow connecting to the one level of agent, yeah, or monitor, so and so.
Yeah.
Is this like, We need to declare this function inside each component, because this is the same set of, you know, code we are actually keeping inside each component. Isn't this like redundant writing this, or it is by default it is there, or just we need to write it is a sort of must or
it is must? Because it is must, because I will tell you why it is must. I'll tell you the inheritance. During inheritance, the function new definition does not get inherited. other task and function definitions get inherited. Hence, it is compulsory to define function new in every class. Is it clear to you?
Okay.
Now, what are we doing? When we define
function. So, SV also we have the construct. This is called as a constructor, right? In SV also we use the constructor. Later we will use the to create object we'll use new. But here we are not using new, right? So then this is to just to tell this class.
No, please understand. Create intern calls new. This is hidden for user. Is it clear to you now?
Yes.
Okay, so when you are creating environment, see, this is where we are creating environment. Now what we are telling is name of env, the parent of env is this. Is this really this? No, this means AHB based test in our example. So one relation got established. This creates one relation. Mean env is child of AHB based test. Like that, as you start creating, as we create all the components of test bench, the whole test bench structure gets created. The UVM can come up with test bench tree. Now why we use test bench tree, what is the need, we'll discuss later. See, if you ask me why do I need family tree in my family, I don't care about others. No, right? There is many times family tree has a meaning. Same way in UVM also test bench tree has a meaning. Where do I stand? What is who is my parent? Who is my children? So it all is important. So same way, that is what UVM also does. It creates its own test bench tree. For it to create, two things we need to pass. You need to give a name, right, for everything. And you need to tell who is the parent. That's all. If you give that, whole test bench tree will get created. Now going by the same concept. So when I define AHB environment class, I have to register it to the factory. The first thing I have to do is UVM component utils AHB interconnect environment. Then I have to copy this function view. These three lines I have to copy and paste here. This was the doubt asked by Ananda. He was telling that, see, anyway, this is the common code you put in every file. Do we really need to replicate it? Answer is yes, because when you do inheritance, function new doesn't get inherited. You have to redefine it every time. Other than that, we have to define function build phase. I'll copy line number 13 to 18, Y5. I'll paste it here. And I will just change it. Let me enable the syntax. In function. Build phase. Here I don't have anything to create because there is no component below AHB interconnect environment. You may say these are there, right? These two are there, but I didn't instantiate them, hence I don't need to create. So I'm in AHB UV or AHB interconnect environment, AHB IC NV in the build phase. What is UVM none? I'll explain you. You are not seeing underscore here, it is there. You are not seeing underscore here, it is there. If I reduce the font, you will see everything. Just that I don't want to reduce the font, hence you just understand here font is there. Here also font is there and underscore is there. Now to run this example, what I have to do? As you start adding more files, you have to include those files in the list, AHB interconnect environment.sv. That's all. Now you go on
run it. Compilation is done. Elaboration is running. Simulation has finished now. You say no. Now you can see earlier we were seeing info to be two. If you remember, we are seeing two infos. Now, since we added one more info, see here we added one more info. That info is also coming. Hence, my total infos are three. See, you can see overall message coming. First, running test AHP based test. Then it is running the test build phase. Then it is running the interconnect environment build phase. So whatever messages I printed, they are automatically getting printed. So the point you see here is I never called build phase. Did I anytime call my build phase in any of the code? We never. Called build phase. However, it gets automatically called when we run. I will answer one second. When we call run test method, the build phases of all the subcomponents, build phases of all subcomponents gets called automatically. Yeah, please tell me.
Sir, you told that whenever we create the create construct, then it will call the function, correct?
Yeah, yes.
Yeah, but sir, in environment, we are not creating any sub environment. So how it will that call that function new of environment?
This is the function new of environment. It gets called when I call create here. When I call create of AHP interconnect environment, this function new of AHP interconnect environment gets called. Why does it
require to do this?
Yeah.
And sir, for the function new of this AHP based test, it will be called in that UVM root.
UVM root, yes.
And second, sir, why this UVM component parent, like it is always be like this argument will be always be same, like it is a universal argument, string name and UVM component.
The parent is, what is the parent type? Parent is of type UVM component, right? Is it correct to write like this? I will give you an example. Can I write function sum integer sum A comma B end function? Is it correct? Can you tell me, is it correct? If I tell return A plus B, tell me what is wrong here. Can someone tell me what is wrong here?
We have to tell the data types of A comma B.
Yeah,
because it returns only integer type.
What is type of A and B? I need to tell. Is missing. Same way, when you define a function in UVM, you have to tell what is a parent type. It is of type UVM component. Like telling somebody's father will be like a human being. So he will be like a human, and it will be name will be a alphabetical name. So that is what I'm telling. Name will be string, parent will be UVM component type. Any other questions you have?
And the second question is like the difference between that two names that we are using during the create, like we are writing create then env we are writing. And upper we are using this instance name like HBIC environment.
HBIC, yeah. See, what we are doing is when we are creating, we are giving a name to it. Here we are not giving any name. We are telling whatever name comes, whatever parent comes, accordingly create that. So that name we are passing as ENV, and we are telling parent is the my base test, HB base test.
No, sir, please open your this top.sv file in full, full window.
Yeah. Which line number?
Eighth line number ENV, and this one, this 16th line.
This is
so both name can be different. Yeah, both name can be different. Yeah.
ENV is instance name, instance handle length. This is the name you are giving to it. These two can be different. This can be different from this. Okay. Any other questions you have?
If we give the different name, so what will be the impact? So like,
there won't be any impact. Name in here. Coding will get impacted. I mean, there will be something called as hierarchical based access, where you need to give the hierarchy names. That time things will be little problem, because maintaining the same name ENV is a suggested programming practice. Even if you use different names, no harm. It will still work. Just that your coding effort will increase little bit.
Okay. And sir, when one we go more to question this, here, line number 11. Okay.
Yeah. Line number?
Line number 11, we are using super, right? So that means we are calling the supermost parent here, like that?
Yeah.
Because every new will have super.
Yeah, I am calling UVM test new, which in turn will call UVM component new, which will in turn call so on. I mean, it keeps calling in a recursive manner till the time the base test gets a name and base test gets the parent. So this concept I'll explain in the next session.
Yes, sir.
So in summary, this will in turn call UVM report object new. This will in turn call UVM object new.
Hello.
Here, name gets assigned. Yeah, please tell me.
Sir, actually in that build phase, sir. As an argument, we are passing UVM phase, we are writing. Hello.
End of elaboration phase.
Hello.
Can you hear me?
We cannot hear anything.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, sir.
There was some audio disruption for small time. Okay. If I run this, the test page structure gets printed. See, from here, whatever message I gave test bench hierarchy, it is printing at line number 22. What is it printing? Name is UVM test of, type is AHP base test, and some size and value. Below test of, there is an environment. What is of type? AHP interconnect environment. So this is how the family tree got created. I mean, test bench tree got created. Did you understood this? Because of what it came? This line alone. This line is printing the test bench structure. Use it to print the
test bench structure. When you run this, S means structure print. S print means what? Structure print. Structure of what? This. Who is this? Base test. So it is printing the structure of AHP base test, which is UVM desktop below the telegram. Is it clear to you?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, actually, I have a doubt. In all the pages, in build page or any other pages, so when you're writing the pages, as an argument, I am passing UVM phase phase.
Yeah. What is your question? Please tell me.
So what does that mean?
The use is basically when you pass
in all the pages, now whenever I write.
Yeah. So going forward, we'll discuss something called as UVM root. Okay. UVM root keeps track of all objections raised and dropped in each component. And UVM also has a concept of phase jumping. To achieve both of these, each method in test bench execution should have UVM phase argument. Basically, to keep track of objections raised and dropped, to you implement the concept of phase jumping, you require the concept of UVM phase to be passed as argument. I will not introduce that, explain that today, because there are many people who won't understand that concept. In the later session, when the time is appropriate, I will explain that concept. Is it fine? Any other questions you have?
Okay.
Now what I will
no,
do
sir.
Yeah, what I will do is, below this top environment, top environment was what? AHP interconnect environment. Below that, I need sub environment, let's say AHP environment, APB environment. I'm just going to develop that, and I'm going to stop this example, because otherwise there is no end, right? I'll have to code agent, I'll have to code driver, I have to code sequencer, everything. So I will not go to that depth, I'll only stop here. So let's just do that. I'm just trying to show you that it is easy to do test bench development using UVM. You may be finding complexity. See, why are you importing? Why are you including? What is this UVM info? What is this create? What is type ID? What is interconnect environment? It is natural for you to have so many questions, and it is natural for you to feel the complexity. See, you will be finding it more complex than system verilog today. But after week or so, as you start doing, you will find it more easier compared to system verilog. So now let us develop the subcomponents. So for that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to uncomment it. I'll call it as AHP interconnect underscore I. APB environment underscore I. Now, as you know, when we code the build phase, we create subcomponents. ENV I equal to AHP ENV type ID create AHP ENV I, same name and this. Same way, we are going to create APB environment type. We have created this. Now, if I run this code as it is, will it work? What is the issue I'll face if I run this code as it is?
You haven't created this AHP environment type.
Hello.
No audio, sir. Hello. Hello.
Your audio gone.
I think Sarah is fixing it.
Is it fine now?
Yes, sir.
Just give me a minute. I need to connect to the server. Can everyone hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what I was telling is, see, in this case, I have created AHB interconnect environment. If I create AHB environment, APB environment below it, I will be able to see further structure also. I can go on creating the structure. Below this, I can create agent. Then below this, I can create drivers, sequencer, monitor, coverage, so on. So I will not, we will cover remaining aspects in the next session. We will not get deep into it because for you, as I start coding more things, you will get, things will get more complicated. So let me just go ahead, cover some basic concepts only right now. So if you see, we have been discussing one important concept called as UVM root. Let us understand what is UVM root. Okay. UVM root is the starting point of UVM test page. It's a very important concept in UVM. Let us understand what is UVM root. UVM root is one of the base classes provided as part of UVM package. It is the starting point of UVM test bench. It plays the role of program block in system bit log.
It is a singleton class instantiated in global scope, which is instantiated as UVM root top. UVM root functionality starts with user calling run test method. When user calls run test, right, automatically the test bench, whole test bench gets started. When user calls run test, the whole test bench functionality gets starts. It reads all the command line argument by calling command line processor. I mean, what we are seeing now is what all things UVM root does automatically without just by calling run test. If you see, if I go to one of my existing codes, any of these codes, somewhere here in the top.sv, when I call run test, here I am calling run test. When I call run test along with the test name argument, now we are trying to understand what all things happen because of that. It does all these things. UVM root functionality starts with the user calling run test method. In turn, when run test is called, top dot run test gets called. When what is top? Top is the this thing, UVM root instance. When user calls run test, whole test bench functionality starts. Reads first thing it does is it reads all the command line arguments by calling command line processor. UVM command line processor is an inbuilt class for reading the arguments. What is the significance of this is I'll explain you. In system Verilog, we would use dollar value dollar plus args to manually read the arguments. In UVM, you don't need to do it. My UVM itself, UVM has a base class called as command line processor, which will automatically do this work for.
Hello, sir. Sir, no audio. Sir, no audio.
Every test name in UVM has instance name as UVM test top. Whatever test you take, it is always instantiated as UVM underscore test underscore top. Next, maintain the phase of simulation. It passes that phase to all test bench component methods as argument. Like someone was asking, right? Why do you pass UVM phase as argument? It is root keeps track of phase of simulation. Basically, root. UVM root keeps track of simulation phase. It passes this phase to all test bench components. So any component to raise or drop objection, they will do on the phase. They will do on above phase.
essentially these objections are reflected in, are showing up in, are collected in UVM route. Now the next question comes is, you may be wondering, what is this objection? We will discuss that in shortly. I mean, the following slides will be objection, what we are going to discuss.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, it is a simulation phase is same, means it is build phase, because in build phase also we are writing UVM phase, phase we are passing.
No, no, simulation phase, there is nothing called a simulation phase. UVM divides all the phases into 8 categories. What UVM does is, whatever we are running test bench, the whole test bench running is divided into 8 subphases. Build phase, connect phase, end of elaboration phase, start of simulation phase, run phase, extract phase, check phase, report phase. Different phases are there. Now we collectively, everything is called as a simulation only. This whole thing is a simulation only. So you don't call it a simulation phase. It depends upon what is our requirement. We call different phases. We implement different phases in different components. Is this your question or you have some other question?
Yeah, okay.
Okay. So the next thing is, so I was using a concept of objection, right? I will explain what is objection in the next slide. Keeps track of objections raised and dropped. Based on that, it will decide when to end the simulation. So basically, objections are used to decide when to end the simulations. Okay. And it invokes UVM command line processor to read all command line arguments. Like, for example, if I do this. Okay. In UVM, we have to, in system Verilog, we have to manually call this way. In UVM, you don't need to do that. UVM will call UVM command line processor and do that. Please remember, it is not for just any name. There are some standard names provided by command line processor. Only those names will be read. If it is something where not in that list, you have to again call dollar value, dollar plus signs. Continuation of UVM route. Reads all command line arguments automatically. That is first thing, which is explained here. For example, if you pass vsim work.top, UVM test name is HP write read test, UVM work host is UVM medium.
Sir, no audio.
No audio, sir.
Sir, no audio. Sir, no audio.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is it fine? Audio quality is fine now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I will repeat. See, what I was telling is UVM has a class called UVM root. It is a very important class in UVM. It is responsible for following. It reads all the command line arguments by calling UVM command line processor. Second, it creates a face variable which is passed to all the components in test bench. Through this face, root keeps track of all objections raised and dropped. And based on number of objections, based on objections raised and dropped, it will decide when to end the simulation. When to end the simulation. And other than that, it automatically creates the test component for the test name passed by user. User can pass test name in two ways. When he writes initial, begin, end,
hello, sir.
I am sorry for this. This is, I don't know, only today it's happening. It generally doesn't happen often. I need to check with internet service provider. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Initial, begin, end. So one is by calling run test, pass the test name. Other by passing, when we run simple elaboration, right?
Hello, sir.
Generally, it does not happen. Okay, I hope you can hear me now. So I was telling about what is the UVM root does. When we run work.top plus UVM test name, AHB write read test, anything, right? It automatically figures out what is the test user wants to run and creates the test component for the test name passed by the user and runs the complete simulation, runs all the simulation phases one by one. Other than that, mostly I think that's all. Because let me repeat again, I think there has been some disturbance. UVM root has a class called UVM. UVM has a class called UVM root. It is very important class in UVM. It is responsible for following, reading all the command line arguments by calling command line processor, creates a face variable called as face. So it is called as UVM face as face, which is passed to all the components in test bench. Through this phase, root keeps track of all objections raised and dropped. Based on objections raised and dropped, it will decide when to end the simulation. And next thing is, it automatically creates test component for test name passed by the user. For example, what root will do is, in this case, it will create AHB write read test as UVM test top. And then it starts all the methods of complete test bench one by one. That is these methods of test bench. So that is about UVM root. Does anyone has questions related to UVM root? So we will just discuss objection and conclude the session for today. First of all, what is a objection? Objection is a concept used by UVM test benches to figure out when specific component functionality is completed. Let me give you analogy. Objection. Analogy. In a court case, let's say multiple lawyers are arguing. Multiple lawyers are arguing. Okay, when one lawyer raises an objection, okay, case can't be closed unless his objection is dropped. The same is the concept of objection in UVM. So that means if any component, same is same in UVM. If any component raises objection, it has to drop the objection. Only then simulation can be finished. Otherwise, it can't be finished. That is the basic concept of objection. Did everyone understand what is objection? If any component raises objection, it has to drop the objection. Only then simulation can be finished. Can you please read this slide once, everyone?
Sir, every component will follow all these phases, right? Build phase, connect phase, run phase.
Tell me.
Every component like UVM environment and UVM test, all this will have all these phases, right? So each one will have separate phases, right?
Yes. Yes, yes, yes.
So like from the run test, so when we give the run test, so which one will start first, sir? So the order of the flow, so that is I'm getting a little confused.
This is the order of flow.
Yeah, first so build will this happen. Is order next flow, but happen. each let's say we have environment, we have agent, we have monitor. So like from where it will start first? So each one will have all these phases, right?
Let me explain it in tomorrow's session because we have that is covered in a separate slide. So as we go forward in the other slides, we will cover all those things in the phases. There will be some phase concept will be there. At that time, we'll understand everything.
Okay. Is there any example, sir?
Now let's. Everything will learn through example only. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So what is the objection? Objection is the concept used by UVM based test benches to figure out whether the component functionality is completed. Okay. Simulation is completed when all objections raised are dropped. If a test bench does not have any objection raised, if test bench does not raise any objections, then simulation completes at zero time. Simulation doesn't run at all. A component raises objection to indicate that component functionality has started. So why does component raise objection? To say that its functionality has started. How does objection is raised? Phase.raise objection. A component drops objection to indicate that the functionality has completed. Simulation can be finished from this component perspective. And next, UVM route keeps track of all objections raised and dropped. There is a concept called a set drain time. What is set drain time? Is it is the additional time for which you still want simulation to run
even after all objections are dropped, even after all objections are dropped, we wait for 100 nanosecond for simulation to finish, because you are setting 100 number here. That is called as drain time. This is the grace time you give for simulation to run for some more time. Let's continue in tomorrow's session, because there is some construction work happening in the neighborhood. They are doing some work today. Let's continue with these remaining topics from tomorrow.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Hello. Sir, that when the components will erase the objection?
Whenever they in the during run phase, they will raise the objection.
Then sir, hello.
Sir. Yeah.
Then sir, whenever we are writing the build phase, you have told two reasons, na sir, for that build phase. Now whenever we are passing as an argument, UVM phase, yeah. Phase. For that, yeah. You have told two reasons. First one is that phase raise objection and drop objection.
Yes.
And second one is to jump from one phase to another phase.
Yes.
And this phase, this raise objection and drop objection, these two are only we are writing in run phase.
In same phase, yes.
Run phase. So what about the build phase? In build phase, there is no requirement of this.
No, build phase doesn't have any requirement of rising and dropping. You can't rise and drop objection because build phase runs only for zero time.
Then sir, there we are writing also that UVM phase, and for that the reason is only for to jump from one phase to another phase, we are writing UVM phase.
Yeah, that's the only probable reason. Otherwise, we don't need a phase there.
Okay, sir.
Sir, this regarding this drain time.
Yeah.
So the drain time means the simulation time, or it's a different like.
No. Drain time is the simulation time only. Let's say if three components raised objection. Okay. Example: if three components of test bench raised objection, and all those objections are dropped at 1200 nanoseconds, and if drain time is 100 nanoseconds, so simulation will finish at 1300 nanoseconds.
Okay, we are giving extra 100 nanoseconds. Okay.
Yes. Now, who will decide how much to give? It is like, see, what is this 100 nanosecond is? You would have passed the last transaction, then you would have dropped the objection. You want some time for last transaction to get processed in the design. Hence, you are waiting for 100 more nanoseconds.
Okay.
Any other questions you have?
So, do we have lab today?
Today there is no lab. Tomorrow onwards we'll start.
And sir, there is an AXI session at 2, right?
AXI session at 2, yes.
Sir, this recording will be available for us?
Sorry? This recording will not be available. Generally, only when you miss the session, we'll share the recorded video with you. This is being actually a demo session. Yeah.
Sir, actually, we are new to this UVM. Na? So lots of concepts you told within this short time. So, you know, to recall all those things, this recording will be available.
That specific thing we'll discuss offline. Okay.
Okay.
Sir. Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Hello.
I can hear you. Please tell me.
Sir, that set drain time is like for that particular simulation of that particular component.
Yes. Generally, it is not particular component. It is called in the test case only generally. I mean, even though it permits us to call drain time anywhere,
but drain time is mostly set during is set in the test run phase, generally not in other things.
Okay. Sir.
Yeah. Yeah, so this is like-